Well, all right, guys, here I am. I've been kind of really having some sharp lung pains for the last 3 days. I had to leave the basement I was staying in. The damp and the cold, I had a what started out as a cold ended up as over a month long pneumonia. I mean, it's drying up right now, but I'm still having really sharp lung pains. So I'm back out in the country right now. And see, like, I've been dying here and, well, not dying, but I mean, shit, I could barely even get up. Every time I breathe, I have this sharp pain in my lungs. It started off, it was just the left lung, now it's the left and the right lung. What I'm gonna do is, the forest is here, that's the real pharmacy. There are some, I understand traditional Asian medicine, and that some substances heat inside, and they're known as yang substances or yang plants. And they cause the body to be warm, hot. Evergreen saps have been used historically by, natives and settlers to treat lung conditions, bronchial affectation. So I'm gonna head out and I'm gonna find some of that for myself. All right, so I'm headed out to collect three things. So I have three of these, plastic bags. I'm not doing this very fancy. This is first aid, last resort. If I don't do this, anyway. The next step, if this gets any worse, like I'm already supposed to have gone to the hospital several times already, and I'm doing the best to treat myself. I know that the hospital, who knows, they may not even, they've never even diagnosed me properly. So, anyhow, I'm pretty sure I can take care of this myself. I'm looking for three things. I'm looking for evergreen sap for some terpenes that include pinene or from balsam or spruce. Some of those saps taste very different. Some of them taste very bad compared to the pine sap. And I'm gonna have to find the specimens of a tree that it's not too big of a tree so that there's not any bark, and I'll be able to collect some sap very easily. I don't need very much. It's very, very strong. It's potent stuff. And it's that yang heat energy. And I'm gonna pick up a few cloves of wild garlic while I'm there. That'll be so the other warming substance. And finally, the wild ginger, which is a very heating substance. I'll be really glad to have that. So, okay. All right, now I'm out here to choose my evergreen tree to collect sap from. And the first thing I come across is I'm on the northern side of a hill. And believe it or not, these are actually evergreen trunks, but you can see they're covered with white green moss. The north side of the tree. So I'm gonna have to find a different spot. All right, well, it might not be the most beautiful specimen. I've seen cleaner trees, but I kind of don't have all day to spend out here and make myself more sick than I already am. But I can find one of these sap bubbles, see? Like the sap bubble here. If I can show it, I'm gonna make a cut underneath here. So I'm just gonna collect that. So far, I've got it fairly clean. You don't need a lot. I'm gonna keep collecting a few more bubbles like that. Shit, sorry, the mosquitoes are getting at me. I'm gonna get a little bit more, and I should have enough after. Okay, since I wasn't able to harvest any pine sap, I don't have time to search for all day for a specimen. I'm sick, I can't stay out here all day. But these are new shoots on this kind of pine. So I collected some of these new shoots here that you see and kept those in the bag. I'm sure I can get some kind of terpene out of those pinene. And I'll boil those up, make my... All right, back to the pharmacy. I brought in the balsam. The balsam sap. And, oh yeah, those green pine shoots. I can't really stay out here for too long because every minute I do, my left lung starts to hurt even more. So, with the cold and the damp there. All right. We're really lucky to have this available. I guess you use what you have, eh? Oh. Sorry, but there's a sharp pain in my lung. I've been stuck with it for 3 days. Oh, okay. So here we're in with the ferns, down by the river. And under here, you'll see all these, roundish looking leaves. Those are the ground running wild ginger. So I'm not gonna need a lot of it. I'm just gonna take a piece or two here. Oh, I'm sorry for being a bit of a pussy today, but it hurts. Well, I guess I'll take two pieces in case I need some later. See, they grow on a... Oh, shit, the mosquitoes too, and the... Fuck. Excuse me. Alright. Yeah, so I'm gonna have to rinse that off when I get in. There we go. Can smell it, though. It smells great. Yeah, the wild ginger. Awesome. Alright, I have what I need here. Didn't get my hands too dirty. I mean, I had to do the balsam sap first. Now I'm gonna go for the wild garlic where I have to dig with my hands. That'll be the last piece I'm gonna collect. So, all right, lucky me. As you can see, the leaves are starting to fall. They're less fresh and alive like these. So they're about at their biggest at this time, and the leaves start to fall. The wild garlic. They keep eating me alive, eh? It was a great year for bugs this year, given the humidity. Oh, yeah. And... Okay. This would be a little bit easier without a camera in my hand. I wouldn't squish the mosquitoes on my shoulder. Okay, there's one. I don't need too many. I'm kind of in a rush to get back inside too, which doesn't help. Okay, yeah, so leeks or wild garlic, as we know them here in Quebec. Find some decent sized ones here. I don't have to come back too often. Oh, there's a nice one. There. I guess 5 or 6 will do. Probably share some with Don as well. He likes them a lot. There's a nice patch. They're close to the surface here. Oh yeah, nice one. Yeah. See, sometimes they're right close to the surface here. Well, at least there aren't any black flies today. I'm anxious to see the dragonflies show up. They take care of the overpopulation of bugs that eat you alive. I'm anxious to see them. Bats and swallows take care of them too. If you can ever make nests or homes for them, to encourage them to move in near your property, that's always a great thing. Okay, I've got 5, 6, maybe a couple more. So I know Don likes them too. While we're here, it's the last minute as well. So after this, they're gonna be too, you know, the green leaves fall off and you actually have to dig under the earth to find them. Okay, so these are the four ingredients: the wild garlic, the wild ginger, the pine shoots, because I couldn't find any pine gum. And here I have the balsam sap or gum, so. All right. Okay, so I have my boiling water ready to steep. In goes this is the wild ginger. So I have it sliced on the, you know, lengthwise a bit. So let the hot water get in there. Oh, and these fresh pine shoots.
For me, you know, listening to them fog and also washing the things that they would put.
A bit piney. Oh, get fog in the camera. And the balsam sap. So there should be, you know, some essence of pine, essence of balsam, wild ginger. And no surprise, I had one piece of wild garlic earlier, and it seemed to provide a little bit of relief somehow, so I appreciated it. I can smell the balsam. Oh, it smells good. So I'm gonna let this steep for a while. I left a few pieces there to freshen up the mix later. I'm probably going to decant that so that I don't have to drink it with all the solids in there. Awesome. Another note before I go away and leave this to steep. You can see there's a lot of color in there. So yeah, there's active in, you know, there's some ingredients from nature's pharmacy in there for sure. It's kind of a nice golden color so far. We'll see what it steeps. After it steeps, what color it'll be. So another little note. Over the past 4 or 5 weeks of being sick with this, you know, it started out as a virus and then it turned into a lung condition after lingering too long. I also noticed when I fed myself a lot, really healthy, you know, the symptoms would worsen. You know, like there'd be more phlegm and more fever and stuff like that. And I'm suspecting that, well, it seems to make sense that, you know, a virus is it seeks a host. And if I were a virus, I guess I'd want to seek out the healthiest host that I could, you know, that would provide the most energy and ability to reproduce and make more virus. So I've been feeding myself a little bit less lately, and I'm going to be having that tea after. Hopefully that'll help. Alright, so I'm indoors right now. I didn't, you know, decant it all off, but you can see the color there. It's not yellow, it's orangish, a little bit more goldish orange. I like it. It's not too strong. I seem to, you know, without measuring of, I guess I have an eye for that. So
gotten bigger and faster.
Yeah, I'm probably going to go have a few puffs of a joint out on the porch, even though I'm already shivering in the house.
I found a journalism fellowship at Stanford and went to Stanford for a year.
I'm going to go and enjoy that out on the porch. It's funny, I was dressed with a, you know, a hoodie, and I have a, one of my winter jackets on, and it was kind of cold in the house. It's not cold in the house, it's just me that's having a temperature reaction, an immune system inflammatory reaction. But no, I had 2-3 sips, that's about it. And that chill effect, I'm now sitting outside on the porch and I feel, you know, a little bit warmer and calmer inside, to be honest. And yeah, so I'm gonna enjoy a bit more of it calmly until, you know, some more comments come to mind. Yet another note. I did prepare my stomach with, you know, several sips of coffee cream, you know, any kind of cream or milk. Just to, you know, in case I would have had some sort of acid indigestion reaction, which I had that the other day, a really severe one. Although, it didn't bleed this time. Over the past 2 years, I had 2 bleeding ulcers. Yeah, it's very scary when you go to the bathroom and, you know. But this time, after the, you know, I've been eating the cannabis for 2 years, and this time when I had the ulcer reaction, I didn't notice blood, not at all, like the last times, you know. The last times there was a bright red puddle, and it scared me, to be honest. I get scared sometimes. And, you know, given the fact I still can't seem to be assigned a family doctor here in Quebec. I don't know if it's because of my family name or what, but it's not because I'm lacking any, you know, real conditions on paper. Yet, you know, I end up treating myself more often than not. And that seems to work out for me for the most part. Wow, that has a nice quality. Like, I feel better already. I was also in a stressful kind of a situation as well. That's part of the reason I'm out here in the country. I need to, you know, let some of the stress off. I need a break. That usually helps. Yeah, so it's not too strong a mix. I didn't add any sugar or honey or anything like that. Of course, I'm used to eating or drinking, you know, medicinal plants and things like that. So it's even if it were a bit bitter, it's nothing new to me. I appreciate those flavors, those natural, clean flavors. You know, it's funny that so much sugar is added to food these days because it actually takes away from the flavors. You know, they could probably use like a third or a quarter of the amount of sugars that they add to foods, prepared foods. And it would, you know, to my taste, it tastes better that way. But I guess that's not the North American norm. That's not what sells, I should say. Add sugar to it, and there you go, it sells. That's kind of like my medicinal cannabis. So the odd time I'd share some, often people didn't know what to expect, you know? They were expecting a buzz. But that's not what, you know, they don't get that tired, puffy, red-eyed, dry mouth effect. Not with the medicinal cannabis when it's finished, so that, you know, it's as clean as possible and the chlorophyll content is as low as it can be, you know, without letting the plant die standing up, but close enough, you know. You want it, personally I like it so that it's not dark green, if I can. have it that way. And without any leftover nutrients, that's for sure. And flowering sugars, those are another aspect that give you the sticky, you know, puffy red eyes and sticky mouth and forget stuff. Yeah, my medicinal stuff doesn't do that. My medicinal cannabis, well, that's finished clean, is more of a performance enhancer than, you know, the Cheech and Chong effect that everybody expects cannabis to be. That's not what I use my cannabis for at all. So I actually want to live my life, and I want to think clearly. I want to be present, you know. I don't get off on, you know, wake up in several years from now, what happened, you know. That's not what I'm into. So I'm really interested in living a healthier life as much as possible and surviving, you know, because given my problems and having a family doctor, a regular doctor assigned to me, man, I had some I still have some serious health conditions to track and take care of, but I'm all alone in doing that. Like, I don't have the help of the, you know, the Quebec government or the medical system. They're just not there for me at all. So, I mean, except for the emergency, but, you know, that doesn't solve your problems long term. Not at all. That's what I'm finding out. So the man who used to be my family doctor, well, he had gone into retirement, and lucky for me, apparently he's reopening his practice 10 years later after the head injury. So he was also the doctor who sent me home from the emergency with an untreated head injury. So I have a meeting planned with my doctor, or the man who used to be my doctor. I still like the man. You know, he did a lot of great things for my family and I. You know, I wouldn't be the person I would be today had it not been for that. You know, either it was a choice of his, or it was a misunderstanding of mine on a day when I was dealing with a fresh head injury. But what I understood was that there's nothing we can do, and you can go home. The fact is, I have, there's a ridge in my skull from where the bones fused back together, which took many years. And the ridge actually grows over time. More calcium and bone develops over that, you know, where it was fractured. And because I don't have, you know, the doctor didn't say, hey, his head was fractured, and write that on paper. Well, it may as well have never happened, because everywhere I go, they tell me, well, you don't have a head injury to live with. Well, excuse me, but I had to live with that every day of 10 years, okay? And I had fever, dizziness, and for the first 2 years, I went through stuff that, you know, I don't tell everybody, because, you know, it's the kind of stuff that if you were explaining to somebody, that they would say, geez, why didn't you go to a psychiatrist or a sanitarium for one of these, you know, for people with that kind of condition, where they, you know, they hear more than their own thoughts. That was the first 2 years after the head injury. It wasn't easy at all. Although, I didn't take any medication, no antipsychotics or anything like that. And I made it through those 2 years all on my own. And I grew from that. And I truly believe, had I taken some medication or antipsychotics, that I wouldn't be as well as I am today. And I wouldn't know as much as I do. And I'm thankful for that. So. Well, that's the last sip of tea. And I guess after this, it's time for some bed rest. Well-deserved bed rest. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm gonna have to take care of myself for the next little while. Good night, bonne nuit, and talk to you guys soon. Okay, so this is 24 hours later, after making and having the tea. And yeah, I had that tea last night. And this morning when I woke up, my lungs were a lot clearer. They were pretty much clear, They were all dried up. I had more volume for breathing. I'm still having a light chest pain if I breathe in very, very deeply, but nothing like what I had for those three days before. That sharp pain that I had in my chest, and it stopped me from sleeping. I had 1 hour of sleep during those nights, and then I would wake up in pain with that sharp pain. It was really painful, the kind of pain that sort of makes you want to pace around. It was really bad. And after I had the tea, whether it be because of the tea or not, to me, it made a whole lot of difference. It dried up my lungs, increased the capacity of my lungs, so I'm able to breathe deeper, and I don't have that sharp pain anymore. So it's worked out very well. And today I had some boxes and things to move, and the night before, or last night, I was really afraid I wasn't going to be well enough to be able to do that. And yet today I was able to get all of that done. And by the time, as I was forcing, I was running into that chest pain because I was exerting force and energy. Oh. And that went, it wasn't as bad as what I expected. I was expecting to not even be able to go up and down the stairs with the boxes. It was really, I was in pain that I couldn't even lay down. And then today I went and I moved all my things. Really, really happy with the results. And all that was fresh pine shoots, since I couldn't get the pine sap right away. The pine shoots were very mild, though. They were very good flavor. The fresh shoots at the very tip of the branches, those were very good. And the balsam sap, that went in there very well. And the wild ginger. Last night I had, I had made a full cup, and I drank it down to about I drank 2/3 of it, so there was about 1/3 in the bottom of the cup. And I left that overnight. And this morning when I looked in the cup, the liquid was black. I couldn't even see through it. So I diluted it. I added some water and filled the cup up from 1/3 back to full. And still it was darker than the solution I had drank the night before, the tea. A lot darker. Only now it doesn't have that yellow, orange, golden color. It has more of a reddish black tint to it. And I'm fairly certain that that is from the oxidization of the terpenes and whatever other compounds are found in the wild ginger. Because I know that the wild ginger is something that, I've picked it and dried it before. When it's fresh, it's green. But as it dries, it turns black. So that, it's a lot like cannabinoids and the terpenes that are found in cannabis, the flavors. As they oxidize, they react with oxygen in the air. In a solution, those molecules are free to roam in the solution, and then they can come to the surface. And, they can react with the oxygen, and they change into a later form of molecule, a different form. And they're a lot darker. So, yeah. reminds me a lot of cannabis when you let it darken, or if you make a cannabis extract and you leave it, say, overnight to react with the oxygen in the air, it'll turn red and black or very dark. Yeah. And even in the cup, if I look at the pieces of the wild ginger, they're very, very darkened already. So, yeah, there's some chemistry going on there, for sure. And I'd imagine that the fresh wild ginger has a different effect than the dried stuff. I noticed that over the winter I was making, because I had, you know, stored some away in a jar after it had been dried over the winter, all those little pieces of dried root, and it turns black, so that the flavor is a lot smoother. It's not as sharp as when the wild ginger is fresh. The wild ginger, when it's fresh, it's very strong. You don't need very much. Whereas with the black, the dried wild ginger, you still don't need much, but it's kind of a smoother flavor. You know, it's easier to swallow, say. Yeah. It's very, very good. And I can't say I'm surprised at the effect, but I'm really happy that I'm back to myself. And I was able to do the things that I needed to get done today, which is very important to me. So, all in all, it's quite a success. I'm going to go in. I forgot to bring the jar with the dried ginger so that I can show it for the camera, for the viewers. So I'm gonna do that now. Alright, so this is the wild ginger that I had, you know, I still have some. It lasted me all winter, even though I did use quite a bit. I used it often enough. And here I'll show it. First I'll take a... Smells very good, but it's a lot smoother, you know, one fresh piece of wild ginger, the flavors are almost overwhelming, but it's kind of perfumey. There's a lot going on in that. It's nothing like cultivated gingers, not even close. There's many other flavors, it seems, in there. So there's more chemistry there, I would say. And yeah, here it is.
See? Now that's a lot darker than the fresh ginger that I had shown for the camera. The fresh wild ginger, I should say. Yeah. So this is the blackened one. It makes very good tea after it's dry. I was able to have it when I wanted some all winter.
It's probably one of the greatest tea ingredients ever. I like it a lot. And really, I try not to use a lot because it is kind of potent. I mean, it doesn't affect me in any bad kind of way. It's just, I realize it's strong. So I only use a little, you know, as much as I need to. Like a very small pinch of this, what I showed in my hand, that's more than I would use for a tea. I would add, you know, a pinchful for many other ingredients for my tea. Yeah. So all in all, a great result. I'm feeling a whole lot better. For a guy who was sick for 4 or 5 weeks, like I said, it started out with a cold virus, and then it turned into a bronchial condition, and then the bronchial condition turned into a really sharp pain in my chest for the last 3-4 days, except for today, where I was able to, even exert force.
Yeah, all in all, it's a success to me anyway. Do I have scientific proof? You know, I share my experiences as honestly as I can. You know, I'm not trying to... You know, if it wouldn't have worked, if it wouldn't have worked for me, or had it not done any, had there not been any noticeable effect or affect, either a positive effect or a negative affect,